2. And so then we get premise 3, which is really just the reasonable pappus assumption, right? Which says that if Abel is free as required for moral responsibility, then she enjoys either freedom-conferring alternatives or a freedom-conferring actual sequence. Again, pretty plausible premise. If what makes us free must be something either about the way things actually unfolded or the way things could have unfolded. And so then we can deduce the conclusion from a couple of inferences. It's modus ponens, disjunctive elimination here, disjunction elimination here, and we can get the conclusion that Abel enjoys freedom-conferring alternative possibilities. And if this conclusion is correct, then we have support for our Pax thesis that the ability to do otherwise suffices for freedom, and we also can falsify Pax from the first two premises alone, right? So from premise 1 and premise 2, if Abel is free but she lacks a freedom-conferring actual sequence, well then freedom-conferring actual sequences must not be necessary for freedom. So that's the basic case. Now, how do we answer some objections? Because the case hinges on the fact that there's a difference in freedom, right? Abel is uniquely free in this case, and Abel's not free, whereas the difference maker is the fact that Abel could have done otherwise, objections take one of two sorts. Number one, the actual sequence folks in kind of defending past can essentially deny the attributions. In other words, they can deny premise one, and they can say, no, Abel's not free or sort of morally responsible, right? Or they can deny the difference maker by looking for flickers of actual sequence freedom, or they can essentially deny premise two, and they can say, no, there are some subtle actual sequence differences here that do account for the difference in freedom. If you're familiar with the Frankfurt cases, these two replies mirror the two main replies to Frankfurt cases, right? So on the one hand, some of the defenders of PAP will just kind of bite the bullet with the Frankfurt cases, and they'll say that, no, the Frankfurt agents, they're not free, right? Because they lack the ability to do otherwise. So we're just going to kind of bite the bullet and say they're not free, kind of despite the putative intuition of the case. So similarly here, they can kind of deny the intuition of the case and say that Abel is not free as required for moral responsibility. Or the defenders of PAP, what they'll do is they'll try to look for flickers of freedom in the form of the ability to do otherwise or alternative possibilities, right? They're like, yeah, well, you haven't completely eliminated, you know, alternative possibilities from the case. And so, yeah, we can accept the responsibility attribution, but what's really accounting for that is the ability to do otherwise. In the same way, the actual sequence folks can look for flickers of actual sequence freedom. And so how do I defend against these? Let's talk about the first objection first. And the objection, again, is that we can deny the freedom and responsibility attribution. I think the basic idea here is that, look, Abel is definitely praiseworthy if she had continued paddling in those cases, right, in this case. But it doesn't seem like Abel's really blameworthy for quitting when the circumstances just made continuing so darn difficult, right? So it doesn't seem like we should really be blaming her in that kind of case. The response that I want to take to this is that I'm not trying to argue that Abel is like robustly free and responsible, such that we're going to like lock her up in jail or whatever, right? So here, if she's meant only to have the very smallest degree of freedom, and that's all I really need here, and so I completely agree that freedom and responsibility admit of degrees, but notice that in the case, it seems like the degree of freedom and responsibility is tracking the degree of the ability to do otherwise. If it were really easy for Abel to continue paddling when she quit, that's going to make her more blameworthy, right? That just made it all the easier for her to do it, so why did she quit, right? But if it were so difficult for her to continue paddling that she could not have continued, that she was like Mabel, well, then we get the intuition that she's not responsible at all. So it seems like freedom and responsibility are tracking the ability to do otherwise. This response also endorses the so-called common account of the difference between a weak will and compulsive action. So both the weak will and the compulsive agents act contrary to their better judgment, right? They're doing the wrong thing even though they know they ought to be doing the right thing. But the difference between the two, according to the common account, originally laid out by Watson in, I think, 1977, is that the weak-willed agent is uniquely able to do the right thing when she does the wrong thing, whereas the compulsive agent was not able to do anything otherwise than the wrong thing because was acting as a result of a compulsive desire, right? An irresistible desire. So in that case, when somebody is compulsive, like let's say the addiction, right, is actually an irresistible desire, such that when that person experiences the urge to do whatever the wrong thing is, cannot resist the urge. In that case, unless we can kind of trace it back to somewhere where they develop the addiction, you know, let's assume that they're innocent people. They develop this addiction from birth or something, right? Well, then it seems like the fault really isn't with them. The fault is with their desires. They're irresistible. They're compelled by their desires. Nothing seems to make them free or responsible in that case. Whereas when it comes to the weak-willed agent, because they're uniquely able to do the right thing, it seems like there's a lack of sufficient effort there, right? That kind of renders them blameworthy. And they could have given it just a little more effort to do the right thing. So when they're doing the wrong thing, now they exhibit weakness of will, and that's such that we can kind of show that they're blameworthy, unlike the compulsive agent. And so that's exactly what we have here with Nabal and Abel, right? So Nabal is a compulsive agent. She's acting contrary to her better judgment, but she couldn't have done otherwise. She couldn't have done the right thing. It was an irresistible urge to quit that was causing her behavior. But then Abel shows weakness of will, right? Where she could have done the right thing, but there was a lack of sufficient effort. So if you're sort of a little reluctant to kind of attribute responsibility to Abel because the chances for success kind of seem so chancy, just stipulate that she has a genuine chance for success such that she's no longer compulsive but actually weak-willed, and we can blame her for showing a lack of effort. So that's my basic response to the first problem. It also kind of shows that we can not only deduce the conclusion from these reasonable assumptions, but it also shows that we can adduce this conclusion together with other reasonable assumptions such as the common account. Seems like we have a good explanation of the fact of why Nabal is uniquely free in this case as well. So then that brings us to the next objection, the last objection here, which is the difference of maker objection. And so the actual sequence, folks, might want to find some subtle freedom-making differences within the actual sequence of events. And this is going to be very problematic for those positions, though, right? Because the case is specifically designed to make it super hard for them to do that, right? Because that's exactly where the case showcases freedom associated with weakness of will. So, Abel is designed to have her freedom to be as clear, to be basically as close to compulsive behavior as possible, right? Way over here, without actually just not becoming compulsive like Nabal, so we can have this sort of intuitive freedom and responsibility attribution, but just enough freedom there and ability to do otherwise such that she's weak of will. But this is really problematic for the actual sequence views, because the actual sequence views originated by analyzing free will in terms of full-blooded action, right? These were the original models of Frankfurt and Watson and everything, the real self-models. On these views, what makes someone free requires a moral responsibility is that they're acting according to their best judgments, to put it roughly, right? According to their preferences, their values, and their desires, their kind of sincerely held preferences, which with they identify such that it's a real self view. They're acting according to their values, their real self, right? But that's never going to be able to explain the freedom of erratic action, because in erratic action, we have people acting contrary to their better judgment, right? So they're not going to satisfy the necessary condition on free will that people are acting according to their values and their better judgments, right? So that just kind of gives you a little example of how these actual sequence views are not going to be able to account for the freedom. I'm not going to go through the Fisher-Revisa other actual sequence models if you're interested in that, and ask a question, I can kind of break it down for you. But since we have the conclusion, once again, we get the past thesis that the ability to do otherwise suffices for freedom, and we falsify the past thesis that a freedom-conferring actual sequence is necessary. So in conclusion, I hope that these models will not see an enemy in the dual model for jettisoning their implausible necessity theses, PAP and PAS, but rather see in the dual model a friend, right? For basically accepting the more plausible sufficiency theses of both models, the past thesis and the past thesis. So if these theorists of the standard models can only lay down their really implausible necessity theses and take up a much more plausible one, the weaker Pappus thesis, the destructive necessity thesis, and then kind of focus on developing their very plausible Pappus thesis, right? Trying to begin to develop theories for what suffices in terms of the actual sequence and alternative possibilities to make us free and require for responsibility, then we can all join one big, happy dual model family and end the stalemate.